I think we're going to do two things here. We're going to start by kind of giving our panelists some time to introduce themselves and their work, what they're working on now, and then we're going to kind of pivot to take some questions from the room, okay? So we're going to kind of operate in that way. Is that reasonable for everybody? I see some head nodding. Thank you again so much for bringing us to this particular point. There is another event after this, so we will wrap up on time, okay? All right. Let's get started. Laura, how are you?
Good.
It's been a long, hopefully an enjoyable day. I want you to talk a little bit about your current position. Is that okay? And tell us a little bit about how you got there. Is that okay? Let's do a little bit of like, here's where I am now, what we're working on, and here's how I found my way to this place. Is that okay?
Yes.
Floor is yours.
And so I'm Laura Gibson. I'm the Director of Workforce Development for Champlain-Hudson Power Express. This has been an amazing day, and we've heard so much, and I wanted to focus in on, we're a job creator. This is a major project that's happening in New York State. It's the biggest climate project that's in construction, and we're generating 1,400 jobs as a result. They're all union jobs, and as a part of the agreement that NYSERDA has with Hydro-Quebec, who's delivering the energy, there are strings attached to it. It was great to hear about Section 3. I started my career in workforce at NYCHA, working on the Sandy Recovery Program, and that was the biggest federal investment at the time into NYCHA, and it came with strings. Like, they had to hire locally, they had to hire from NYCHA residents. And this is a trend that's continued through all the work that we do, that now that my job exists, but it didn't before. This is something that the government wants developers to do so that they can see we're making an active investment back into the community for workforce. So when I think about this, I'm thinking not only about our project, but also about the literal trillions of dollars that's coming from the federal government that will all have community benefit agreements attached to them. I've heard several people just this week talk about that from the White House, and how we can continue to work as a community to make sure that not only these requirements are continuing, but that they're upheld and that they're rolled out equitably so that we can change the climate industry to really be something that works for everyone. But just to share a little bit about our project, it's exciting because it's real, the jobs are real, we're in construction, we're hiring now. It's a 339-mile transmission line that's delivering all 100% renewable clean energy from Canada, Hydro-Quebec, down through New York State, eventually landing in Astoria, Queens. So once we're finished, we'll have 20% of all of New York City's electricity coming from that energy source. It's a dramatic reduction in carbon emissions. It's the equivalent of taking 44% of all the cars off New York City streets in just one swipe once we plug into the grid. And everyone in Astoria is pretty excited about it, given the health implications that they've suffered for decades there. But it also has a lot of benefits for the economy. We are the second largest private investment into New York State, so there's $1.4 billion that's going to 150 communities throughout the line. We have a $117 million environmental trust, and we have a $40 million green economy fund that I work on that is open now, actually, if you are interested in applying. But the goal is to connect low-income and disadvantaged workers into good jobs in the climate industry. So these are all a result of like community pressure on government, on developers to make this stuff available, and I think it's something we should continue to ask for and ask even bring more.
Thank you for that opening. It's a massive project with tremendous implications, and so I'm grateful for you being here today to talk to us about what's happening, how it's happening. A couple of key parts came up. I think the audience probably heard the word funding came up, but I imagine alarm bells went off as that happened, because folks were thinking about that. We've also heard something there about union job opportunities. And on that note, Nicole, why don't you introduce yourself and let us know a little bit about you and what you do.
Hello, good afternoon. My name is Nicole Bertrán. I'm the Executive Vice President of the Edward J. Malloy Initiative for Construction Skills, which is an apprenticeship readiness workforce development organization in New York City that prepares New York City public high school seniors and adult New York City residents for careers in the unionized construction industry via the pathway of apprenticeship. That's my elevator.
Love it.
Okay, so before construction, I've been in construction skills since 2008. Before construction skills, I worked for the New York City Department of Small Business Services on the Executive Order 50 initiative that was actually originally out of the Dinkins administration, which I was in elementary school then. Out of the Dinkins administration that was resurrected in the Mayor's Commission on Construction Opportunity in the Bloomberg administration to make sure that laws, rules, and regulations are followed by contractors receiving funding from the City of New York to employ workers on their construction projects. EO 50, old legislation, had never really got traction. While I was there, I got the invitation to apply to construction skills. Before SBS, I worked for a non-traditional employment for women for many years, and worked on developing their apprenticeship readiness training, which still exists today, the daytime and nighttime training. And that was sort of my first job out of college, but that is where I got accidentally involved with all you guys. But I'm happy to be here, and I don't know, I guess you'll ask me other questions.
That's good. And this is a familiar face in the room. Gaspar, it's great to see you. Like everyone else, you want to talk a little bit about the journey and what you're working on now?
Sure. Thank you, NYCTC, Greg, for the invitation to come and speak to the group here. Hopefully we get to offer something new to you all based on compared to what you've already heard. Those who do know me, I was the Lower East Side Employment Network's coordinator and partnership director for 11 years, from 2012 to 2023. And then I spent a year with CUNY as its green economy industry specialist, helping index the university's engineering and geoscience programs, and serve as the front door greeter for companies that wanted to do green economy work with the university. So I did a good amount of research or learning about green jobs and green economy, so I think that might be something that I can offer the group. And now I'm the Workforce and Economic Development Specialist for Attentive Energy. We're an offshore wind company. We have a lease area off the coast of New Jersey and New York, with half of it currently being contracted to deliver energy to New Jersey, and the other half is currently unaccounted for, but we did recently bid for solicitations from New York and New Jersey to provide power to one of those states. So that's who I am and what I'm currently doing. For Attentive Energy specifically, I'm responsible for, with a team of three of us, coordinating and ensuring that our community and economic benefits commitments to New Jersey are fulfilled. We are required to deliver $105 million in funding to overburdened communities in New Jersey. Stephen Levin mentioned the New Jersey Economic Development Authority, $7 million. Some of that is ours.
What we're gonna do is, so in terms of heavy hitters, I mean, I feel like we really did everything we could today to try to make sure this audience had the heavy hitters to think and react to both the work that's happening now and the work that's planned for the future. We're in a place where we can solicit questions from the group because we did want to have a town hall vibe here, so we want to take some questions. So this is going to be like the off-script moment. I'm going to start it though by asking you an off-script question that is not necessarily specific to the green space, but it's connected. I'd love to know, based on the three of you, based on your history and experience, what does workforce development mean to you?
That is off-script.
Intentionally so. I'm curious. And again, because of your both, for the three of you, your backgrounds, your expertise, and what you're working on now, I'm curious how you define it. And I bring it up partially because I think we really struggle, and I think elected officials, other folks, I think folks really struggle to understand what we think about when we think about workforce development. So I'd love to hear your perspective. And I'd love to hear from each of you on this, just as a starting point, and then we'll go with Greg.
So workforce development to me is a way to, really simply, a way to connect workers to opportunities for a vibrant life. So unionized construction is one of those opportunities, right? That offers training, education, high wages, benefits for themselves and their family, to lead a middle class lifestyle. What does that mean? That's sort of maybe a vague term, and maybe it ebbs and flows as with the economy. But I think that the importance of being able to support yourself and your family through these opportunities is workforce development to me. And that lies in the apprenticeship system, but I won't keep going. That's one of the apprenticeship to me, and we can talk about this, and maybe there'll be some questions from the audience, but apprenticeship to me is the original workforce development initiative.
Happy to go next. I think that, I mean, I assume this is a workforce development professional's room. You all have your own very accurate and rich definitions. For me, it's something that my mentor would describe as someone's looking for a job, and you help them get it. Or put on the other end of the labor market equation, there's a company looking for talent, and you're helping them get it. So that fundamentally is, and most simply, what I think workforce development is. And there's a lot of logistics and strategy. I think that experts have strategy doing that, making that happen.
Great answers. From my perspective, I will say it's not HR. I get a lot of HR emails from recruiters, but it's something that I've always worked on the side of like the employer or the developer or the government creating these jobs, and it's critical that we're all playing a role in this ecosystem, because we are making jobs available. We're requesting workers from local zip codes. We're requesting people from disadvantaged areas now, from NYSERDA. So the jobs are becoming available, but what's most important to me is that we're not just hiring the people that are currently qualified, which for us is a full-fledged union member, but we're also investing in the pathways that will take someone who right now has no job, no qualifications, but an interest in getting a job, and investing into the training programs that connect folks that way. And then having, you know, community partners feed into those training programs so that we can then hire them. But I think that as more developers come on and more community hiring from New York City, which I worked on, starts rolling out, we can create demand and then work together to make sure that those jobs are going to the people that need them the most.
I appreciate you sharing that. I think it's something we need to think about, is how we talk about the work, especially as we think about creating that workforce development agenda for New York, and how we think about holding elected officials and others accountable for investing in the communities and the opportunities that you flagged. On that note, I'd love to turn it over to the audience for questions. Who's up?
Not all at once, guys.
Floor short.
Another kind of question about how do we know what companies to be pursuing. And the truth is the information is kind of scattered everywhere, as is normal for New York City workforce development, but honestly, we're nationwide. And
is that true? Do you feel like the information is scattered everywhere in terms of who's doing what where? For green, for sure. Sorry.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about specifically, is the green economy. But I think NYCTC put out a great report, not report necessarily, I think it was a newsletter that went in pretty deeply about green economy. The city, New York City, put out a really great report on green jobs. There is that information out there. It does take some work to search for it. You'll come across it eventually, hopefully quickly, to have a definition. My take on how to find them is probably to look through those resources, see the categories of the companies that are represented in those reports, and then those companies that are mentioned, using them as examples, and trying to find who their industry competitors or peers are, to expand your understanding of which companies. And for us, specifically with Attentive Energy, being an offshore wind company, renewable energy, the way to successfully work with us is, I think, mandated by the state of New Jersey. We're required to deliver at least 2,000 new jobs to the state. And this is the norm for any of these new large-scale renewable energy projects that have Inflation Reduction Act money and that are awarded by NYSERDA or by the New Jersey Board of Public Utilities. We have to do this. So that is the main path to success, is knowing that a lot of these companies are required to do it in order to get tax breaks or tax credits in order to be able to fulfill their requirements for their projects. And I think that just having a sense and an understanding of all of that is the place to start.
Feel free to add on.
Okay, I think you covered it from the developer perspective, and I wish they were reaching out to you, but in the future, that hopefully will be the situation. Because like Gaspar said, all of these projects have requirements to work with communities. And there can be requests made, and the more requests that are made, and the more follow-up, and the more engagement, the better. And so I would agree with his perspective to look into who's bidding on the money and talk to them before they get their project so that you can be a part of their proposal.
This is where things get tricky, I imagine, because not everyone has those relationships, those resources, or the capacities, right? I'm a good training provider, I run a great program, I don't necessarily have the size or weight to be able to enter into these conversations. That disconnection, I think, has been flagged throughout the course of this. So absolutely hearing you, we've got to do some work. Workforce providers have to do some work, and the employers have commitments to make, but I also heard about mandates, too. But please, jump in.
Well, construction skills refers our candidates or places our candidates directly into unionized apprenticeship programs. So I think maybe explain this.
Yep.
Okay, so the unions, two things I want everyone to know just based on what I've heard today. Number one, unions are not unilaterally determining their class size, when recruitment happens, or who gets brought in, okay? Who gets brought in is one of those, but not when. All union apprenticeship programs, construction or other industry sectors, are regulated in New York State by the New York State Department of Labor. So the New York State Department of Labor determines when a union can bring in new candidates and how, right? That, I think, is maybe demystifies some areas of frustration or both, or confusion and frustration. So there's that. That's the general recruitment. Right? So there's three ways individuals can enter into the unionized construction industry in New York State. So there's general recruitment. All that information is always posted publicly on the New York State Department of Labor website. So if you go to that website, and their website's a little confusing, sorry guys. But if you put an apprenticeship into their search engine, that comes up. And it's organized by region of the state. So obviously, if you're in New York City, you would look at which unions are recruiting in New York City, and you will find when recruitment is happening, how to go about it, whether it's in person or online, how the applications are being given out, what the application due date and deadlines are, and requirements, if there's aptitude, if there's physical exams, if there's whatever the entrance requirements are for that specific trade. The baseline is construction skills entrance requirements are aligned with the baseline requirements also, which are at least 18. Some trades you can be 17 with a parental sign-off. At least 18, eligible to work in the United States, eligible or able to perform physical labor, and committed to a clean and sober environment. Many of the unions do still do drug testing, and marijuana is still a drug, but that's the tricky part of what's happening, but that's along with all the requirements for a safe work environment, right? Because people are doing difficult work. The third way, which is the way that construction skills is able to provide access to these opportunities for our participants, is called direct entry. Direct entry is a New York State Department of Labor designation that enables each union or each, each union to write in the direct entry program into their affirmative action plan. And so, outside of the recruitment, when new apprentices are brought in, they're able to contact a direct entry program and say, send me this many folks to test, interview, whatever the entrance process is. So I hope that provides some sort of clarification on what happens. And one of the reasons why it's so frustrating is because I guess that's not known, and it's not really explained anywhere clearly on a website, or maybe I should make an FAQ or something, but that's how people enter into the unionized construction industry. And again, most people do enter through direct general recruitment.
Questions from the group and from the audience, either building on that or more? Karen, yes. We can hear you.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Thank you for, you know, great ideas throughout the day, right? We've heard a lot of really great ideas, from digital solutions to working with employers differently, to working with each other better, to the need for funding for collaboration, because we know collaboration is the way to success for all of us. Especially hearing all of your backgrounds and knowing where you are now, I would love to know what, from what we heard today, really resonates with you as, like, tackle this first. Because what really hit me was the employer from Toro Construction saying she feels like Green City Force is her best kept secret. And that's a problem, right? Like, workforce development is a secret still. I worked in the private sector for 9 years. I didn't know any of this existed. And I would imagine there are so many employers that is the case. They don't even know we're doing this work. So, you know, that's one thing. Like, how do we fix that? I don't know, a marketing campaign. But from everything you heard today, I would love to know, like, yes, tackle that first, tackle that second. I'd love to hear what you all think.
Go ahead.
Okay. So, one of the first panel, there was a lot of discussion around being more collective and collaborative efforts. And one of the things that I'm also responsible for is I'm the chair of the Apprenticeship Readiness Collective, or ARC. And the Apprenticeship Readiness Collective is a horizontal collective of four sovereign nonprofit organizations. They are Construction Skills, the program that I work for, Non-Traditional Employment for Women, or that I used to work for, and Helmets to Hard Hats, which is for veterans of the United States military, and then Pathways to Apprenticeship, which is for the formerly justice-involved individuals seeking careers in the unionized construction industry. So together, our four programs collaboratively work for a few reasons. It's out of the Building and Construction Trades Council, and one of the efforts is an educational campaign that is implemented in the form of learning days. So what we do, maybe you've heard of this, you're nodding, great, but we go out to different communities, and not just the ARC affiliates, but also the union affiliates of the Building and Construction Trades Council, to let people know this project is coming to your neighborhood, or this is an opportunity you may not have heard of, these are the ways in, and it's part of the education campaign. So that's one of the things that I thought was really important and for me to mention, because we are already doing collective work and working together to inform people of these opportunities and offer the opportunity to enter the industry that way.
I like that.
Thank you.
Thank you. You know, an idea thankfully popped into my head while Nicole was wrapping up. And, you know, how do we inform business about what workforce development has to offer? The idea that popped into my head is that maybe we need to have government offer a credential or certification to businesses if they complete some sort of an orientation about workforce development. You know, there's a lot of requirements on what you can and can't do with job applications. For example, bang the box. You're also not allowed to withdraw a job offer due to a positive cannabis test, except for industries that require safety training, construction, or healthcare or medicine. But you know, maybe we could add something like a workforce development certification. And I don't know what the carrot would be. Government isn't so into sticks anymore. But you know, I don't know if it's, we always go to tax credits in the United States, but maybe there's another way to incentivize businesses to get this type of a certification, and that could go a long way.
Oh, I mean, I can add, thank you for the question. It's also nice to see you in person. I think you're going to do quite a bit. Thanks for your work with the Green Network. So we do work with the ARC on our project, and I have for many, many years. And just an example of something that happened recently with Pathways to Apprenticeship, they're one of the building trade recognized pre-apprenticeship training programs that not only do the trades recognize them, but they've set aside space in their upcoming apprenticeship classes for workers specifically from those programs. So it's more than just getting direct entry status, it's building relationships, which takes a long time. But they have come out to Astoria where we're plugging into the grid and done information sessions with our community partners that are active on the ground, but it's still really hard to recruit for these openings. And we're finding that's an ongoing challenge. And then with our fund, we want, so Steve Levin said it earlier, like the big dollars are with government, the $100 billion budget. When I was there, was a $17 billion goods and services budget every year from the city. So there's a lot of funding available for job training, but we want to make sure that it's doing so we're actually tapping into the neighborhoods and the communities that we're seeking to hire from and recruiting from them. So more collaboration and just getting the word out perhaps would be all something that is worth investing in. So I agree with you.
Can I add to that? Workforce development plays a huge role in that, not just informing people about the opportunities, but preparing them for those opportunities. So it's not just send your resume and show up, you know, whenever you think you should show up for your interview, right? It's what should be on your resume? What skills do you need? What experiential services can you offer to that employer, right? What do you have on your resume? What do you need to have on the resume? What can be offered through workforce development? Is it a certification? Is it a license? Is it some other opportunity that you're not aware of yet? And so that's part of the learning day experience. And the education campaign that we're very invested in and letting people know to demystify it and explain the way that it works so that, I mean, I get calls all the time, well, I never got a call because it's a lottery. General recruitment is a lottery, right? Did the lottery ever call you? No, me neither. probably not. If they did, don't raise your hand. but that's the one of the challenges is that most people enter that way, even though it is a lottery and it is a major source of frustration and confusion for folks. So that's what we're here to do.
We have time for one more question. Floor is yours.
Great. Thank you all so much. I'm really grateful to be here with everybody in the room, truly. Build on Gaspar, right? What we were saying about this idea of credentialing employers. You know, like the weight has always been on job seekers to be credentialed and ready for employers. And really
So there are probably close to 25 or 30 direct entry programs that have earned direct entry status through the Department of Labor. The Building Construction Trades Council recognizes 4 that are also written into project labor agreements that the BCTC negotiates with for different projects. So that's why there's 4. The other thing is, if let's say, and I'm not good at math, so I'm just gonna say 100. Let's say if 100 people are being brought into an apprenticeship program and 45% of those seats are going to direct entry candidates, that means 55% are going to the people that are standing on a line, applying through the general recruitment. And just because you come from a direct entry program does not mean you may not also go through the general recruitment, so you actually have, you know, double your chances. But those are the 4, and it's not my decision, I'm not the big boss. The 4 programs that are part of the collective, and for now, it looks like that'll be the 4.
Final thoughts. We're wrapping up. We're running short on time. Thank you for the questions. They were great. Final thoughts for this group. As we've asked in each panel, what is it that you want the folks in the room to carry with them as we continue on this work together, continue to build towards good outcomes for New Yorkers, specific to the green economy or green college job, but I think we're talking more broadly about how it is that workforce development and economic mobility are things that we can rely on and see, regardless of the region or community we're thinking about. So final sort of thoughts and regards you want us to sort of remember as we proceed. Gaspar, why don't you do this?
I'm really glad you're not locking us in the room, especially because we're
no
going to leave by 3 o'clock. So what to leave? It's scary times, but it's also kind of really exciting times. I think that we are very much at a fork, and a lot of jobs are coming back to the United States. The Inflation Reduction Act and the Bipartisan Infrastructure Law are a huge reason for that. It's, you know, why I think that we have viable projects in renewable energy. So I think maybe to take some encouragement on that, that we really do have, we're on the precipice of real opportunity to grow that and to feel hopeful. You know, the workforce development is really difficult work because we're kind of being buffeted by these like major structural systemic challenges and problems. And in order to keep navigating through that storm, you know, just being encouraged and empowered and recognized for the really great and important work you all and we do.
So I think that this conversation and categorizing work as green or an individual as a green carpenter, which we did talk about earlier, that detracts from the reality that there is a demand for labor and an eager and perhaps unemployed labor supply. So we have an opportunity to build an equitable, clean economy that is powered by good union jobs. That's all I got. I can keep going.
We'll take it.
Well said. Yes, I agree. And I mean, from my perspective, it is construction. Now it's green construction. But I just want to share, like, I went to our job site and talked to the construction workers, and it was the first time they learned that they were on a climate project. Like, they're just doing their construction jobs. And they will continue to work when our project doesn't need them. They'll go to another job, and that's the beauty of being in a union. And I know that it is, I think that we're seeing this with our fund, and like we want to increase collaboration. There's more to just the actual training. There's also recruitment, there's mentorship, there's retention and advancement. Like, there are areas where we can all work together versus starting new training programs and work directly with the unions. So I think there's going to be a lot more, I hope, many more projects that are like ours that have similar goals, and that we can use this as a way to set a standard on how the work is done.
Give them a round of applause, everybody. Whether you joined us first thing, the first panel of the day, or you joined us along the way, I thank you. I hope that what you learned listening today, receiving, was beneficial. Even more important, I hope that separate from what happened up here, what happened right over there, connecting to people.